peace and blessings, beautiful soul, respect and honor. I am Brandi L. Bates, and this is Power Podcasts. Happy 420. You can find me on Twitter at Soledad Francis and on Instagram at Brandi Is Winning. Also, these podcasts are archived on YouTube at YouTube channel I Am Brandi Bates, and we are newly on SoundCloud, so search for Power Podcasts on SoundCloud. And you can find us on groundlevelradio.com on Tuesdays at 6 p.m. to 7 p.m. Pacific Standard Time. Shouts out to DJ B Smooth. We're syndicated, baby. Tell a friend to tell a friend. We're here to help you level up your go hard swag. That's what Power Podcasts is about. So today we're talking about striking while the iron is hot. Windows of juicy opportunity. Windows. And how crucial it is to act decisively and take your opportunities when they arise. Folks, you have to walk in authority. No matter what your, you know, socioeconomic background, no matter your education level, no matter your intellect, no matter what your job title is, walk in authority. Do things decisively. Nothing happens by chance. Every action has an equal reaction or consequence. Every action. Think about that before you do something messy, say something, you know, offhand. We have a small window of time in this life to make our mark. We live in a world where everything is connected to everything else. And as technology and the web improves, you can see how we're all connected by 7 to 8 degrees of separation. Everybody. And everything in the universe moves, vibrates, and travels in circular patterns. This applies to everything. Everything, everything, everything. Words, feelings, and thoughts have their own unique vibrations. And so we must engage in thoughts and action that support our dreams, support our goals, our aspirations. Baby, if it's not in alignment with your aspirations, then it's not worth your time. Point blank. These are universal laws. This is metaphysics. This is the highest science. This is the highest religion. Universal law. And understand that negative energies attract negative energies. And positive entities and energies attract positive entities and energies and events and situations and circumstances and souls. And each of us can change the energies in our lives to affect change. Spark change. Speak truth to power. Each of us in this heroic journey, in this pilgrimage through life. Life is a pilgrimage from cradle to grave. It's a journey. And each of us will be tested, challenged, and bestowed with problems to be tried by the fire, if you will. There's always someone in a better position than you, and always someone in a worse position than you. So don't compare yourself to others, because it's always going to be somebody doing way better than you, and always those who are less fortunate. I like to talk about, you know, it's so many. Sometimes I like to play devil's advocate, and I have friends who, you know, we get in discussions and we start talking about white privilege and, you know, patriarchal privilege. But I'm like, have you ever considered for a moment that you have American privilege? There are privileges that are bestowed upon you just by virtue of you being born in the U.S., just by virtue of you being born into a family, in a system that enables you to get to go get the money. You weren't born in a little small remote village in East Asia where they're, you know, the cost of living and you know, they're surviving off 5 cents a day. There's a privilege that comes with that. And whenever I travel, the one thing that they notice right off is that I'm American. I'm melanated. I have locks. I go to Central America and they're like, "Eh, man, nati dread." But when I open my mouth, they hear that I'm not speaking their native tongue. I don't have the native tongue coming off my voice. So with that, I'm treated a certain kind of way because I'm an American. So think about a window of opportunity. What does that look like, right? A window of opportunity is a short time period during which an otherwise unattainable opportunity exists. And after the window of opportunity closes, the opportunity ceases to exist. It's like a stargate. It's like a portal. And it opens in your life, in the business world, in the corporate world, physically, in the physical, biological, tangible life, you know, opportunities, that small window. And since good deals on things like real estate, business offers, all that, they don't exist forever, the window of opportunity is the ideal time to act. So case in point, all the men and women who sold their homes just before the great real estate bust in 2006, 2007 in the U.S., they won, right? They won. Everybody else crapped out. So the hours, you know, average people, average performers misuse, the excellent producer leverages. One thing I loved about Kobe Bryant, back when he was with the Lakers playing, he would just, before every game, he was shooting shots and practicing while everybody out, you know, in the various cities they would travel to for the games. They're out partying, drinking, whatever, getting groupies, whatever they do. And he's spending hours and hours and hours of just shooting the ball, right? Time you trick off, somebody else has done 10 to 15 things in the time you tricked off on Facebook. On time you trick off on Snapchat, time you tricking off on YouTube, you know, they've done 10 productive things to forward their cause, to forward them, right? Juicy opportunity comes in those small windows of time. And as you get older, you come to realize how day by day, you have less energy to execute on your great ideas. Day by day. This is why it's crucial for you not to squander your younger years making needless mistakes. Learn from other people's mistakes. OPM. Other people's mistakes. That's one of the greatest lessons you can ever learn, because it will save you years and years of headache, heartache, years and years of money and hard times. You can be the smartest person in the room, have a market-making product, carry remarkable talent within you, and have a future filled with pure opportunity. But without world-class energy, you will never produce world-class results. You just won't. Now, how many of you know that mistakes are expensive? Mistakes are, a mistake is so expensive that there are certain mistakes that can literally take the breath out of your lungs for a moment. Do you hear what I'm saying to you? I know we all have experiences and things, relationships and things we've experienced, and we wish we could just turn back the hands of time and be like, "I wish I never met that person." Right? Or I wish I never walked down that street. I wish I never went to work on that day. Or I wish, you know, I never experienced that. because it was a mistake ultimately. Hindsight is 20/20. But looking back in retrospect, you can say, you know, gosh, that mistake was expensive. But a lot of mistakes we can avoid if we learn from other people. It's other people's mistakes that, for me personally, is why I was never a teenage mother. No shade on teenage mothers. I just don't ever want to be one. I would never want to be a teenage mother because you lose out on so many opportunities. And so when I was younger, you know, I had a couple of friends within high school who had babies, and they couldn't go to any of the parties. They couldn't go to any of the pep rallies, the games. You know, when it came time to just party, and they really had to either be at home taking care of their baby or working a job to provide for their baby. And, you know, meanwhile, those of us who didn't have that kind of responsibility or obligation, we're out chilling, enjoying life. And, you know, again, no shade, because we all have our own paths. I'm not here to judge anyone, you know. But I'm just saying, certain things I see as a mistake. And whatever is in your reality, however you choose to define a mistake, learn it from somebody else. Let somebody else pay the cost better than you. So, some lessons can cost you your life. Bottom line, some lessons are so hard fought that they'll drain you of everything you've got, including your spirit. We all know people who've been so beat down by life, so beat down by this society, by unscrupulous people, by the man, by hard times and hard lessons, that they've just, you know, given up. Spirit beat out of them, given up hope and any concept of better times. And so they grow bitter. They grow bitter like it's, you know, a second skin. And once you've lost your will, you've lost it all. Understand, willpower is like a muscle. Flex it and it grows. But once you've lost it, it's gone. So one of the most valuable resources I believe we have, humanity, is that of our mental focus. Our mental focus. Life gives us what we give it. Without extreme concentration on your craft and vital few priorities, you'll spread your brain's bandwidth over many things and ultimately end up genius at nothing. And so by dialing in your focus, you'll leverage the neuroscientific rule that says neurons that fire together wire together, right? And so that's one of the pitfalls of social media. You can't allow yourself to get too caught up in this shit. Too many among us endlessly, you know, we playing games, you know, games on our phones and we numb out with all this digital surfing and just waste our brilliance watching mindless TV shows. Really think about that. When you think about how short life is, and when you subtract the time that, you know, you subtract the time that you're sleeping, subtract the time that you don't have any control over, right? Life is short. And when you consider how much of it you trick off just watching TV, mindless TV, not shit that, you know, valuable shit that enhances your life, but you'll squander precious time surfing the net, tweeting, posting, and just staring at worthless photos. So no shade, but if you're tricking off time, you can be investing in bettering yourself, mind, body, and soul, spiritually, financially, psychologically. On social media, you'll miss your window of opportunity. You'll miss those windows of juicy opportunity. Your massive focus activates a certain type of brain cell called an oligodendrocyte, which then triggers the production of myelin, right? That's a fatty tissue that wraps around the neural pathway, and it's related to the skill you're practicing. And myelin, we talking about brain matter. Myelin, this is science. Myelin is the material of genius, because in many ways it accelerates your learning speed. It heightens your perception. This is how Wayne Gretzky was able to skate to where the puck was, not where it is, where is it going? That's why I talk about vision a lot. You have to have vision, a vision of your future. You have to see it in clear detail. People, I can't imagine. Who knows? I can't even imagine what it'll be like. And guess what? You won't. And so whenever it comes, whatever it is that comes, it's gonna knock you off your feet, because you didn't put forth the vision. You allowed somebody else's vision to just captivate you. But only, this is for my artists out there for a second. I'm talking to you. You only release work that is at a level of poetry. Watch what starts to happen to you. Stop putting out shit if it's not up to par. You have to have standards. And if the quality is not up to those standards, don't release it. It's okay to be prolific. I for a moment in time in my life, I would write a book every year. And I started to study some of my mentors and study some of the greats. And I realized some of the greatest shit, the greatest books you can ever devour mentally, were written over the course of years, some decades, right? And that's the stuff that lasts and goes down in perpetual history. Not the dime novel, pulp fiction and shit that's just coming out, churning out. Think about it as an artist. Do you want to be the kind of artist who drops albums and mixtapes every single quarter or every single 3 to 6 months? Or do you want to be like one of the greats who lasted timeless, right? It's like Anita Baker. I know it's old school. It's old school, but Anita Baker came out with a handful of hits. But Anita Baker can still pack out a stadium and just play all her old shit without recording or releasing any new shit, and will pack out a stadium. Same thing for Tina Turner. Tina Turner hasn't written music in years, right? Old school soul. But Tina Turner can still pack out stadiums all around the world, wherever she goes to. If it's a Tina Turner tour and she draws in all types of ethnicities, all types of genders, ages, you name it, they love her. And it's because she's just put out classic level of poetic poetry, classic shit. So as an artist, who cares what you do behind closed doors and when you get in the lab and you get in the studio, go in your zone. But in terms of what you release to the public, you have to make sure it's at level best, right? While I'm at it, talking about level best, recalibrate your diet. What you eat affects your moods. It determines your longevity. It drives your energy. It stimulates your metabolism. It's building your future body. Every 7 to 10 years, our cells die and reproduce and create. We're all new cells all throughout our body temple. And what you eat determines the quality of those future cells. So no more processed food, right? You eat shit, you are shit. You are what you eat. You eat shit, you are shit. You eat junk, you are junk. Because literally you are, because you're literally building cells and arteries and blood and bone and flesh. You have to give your vehicle high octane fuel. High octane. We're getting too old to be, running off top ramen and frappuccino. You know damn well, you 25, 30 years old, you at work eating hot Cheetos for breakfast. Hot Cheetos and a Pop-Tart and a Diet Coke. So Everyone is an artist. Each of us has exceptional levels of creativity within us. This is a fact. Facts. Longing to see the light of day. But for our finest ideas to show up, we need to set up the conditions for them to come out to play. It takes years, not months, to train yourself on getting into that space mentally and building the willpower, building your willpower muscle. Remember, if you flex it, it will grow. You think about Navy SEALs. Navy SEALs put themselves in hard circumstances. This is just training, right? The SEALs, they put themselves in these circumstances designed to break them. And they do this to make themselves unbreakable. Boxers, you see in the morning, they're shadow boxing, they're jogging. They do their early morning road work so they're resilient in the ring, right? All superb producers, the doers, go to where their discomfort lives. Go to where your discomfort lives, for there your highest power lies. We're talking about windows of juicy opportunity. Juicy. Because our peers and the media influence us to want, you know, what the majority wants, right? Behave as most people behave. Live the best hours of our finest days in the same box of unlimited possibility that all the rest of the 95% of people play. Our teachers school us on the methods of thinking and ways of being that they've learned as their reality. And it's funny because most people's reality is based on social constructs, not truth of universal laws, nature and shit, how shit really is. It's these ideas, these constructs that we set up in society. And that's a modus operandi that will always leave you in perpetual mediocrity. Perpetual. Because the exceptional ones among us have always deviated from the path. Think about that. Rosa Parks, defiant. Dr. Martin Luther King, Gandhi, right? When you speak truth to power about civil disobedience, right? You think about people who have deviated from the path. Those are the exceptional among us. You're never going to write history. You're never going to make history. You're never going to leave a bold legacy unless you deviate from the path. Our well-intended parents program us with the beliefs wired into them. And I talk about, you know, how we attack problems and do things the same way our elders did it. And they're doing it the same way their elders did it. And we wonder why we don't go anywhere. And that's what I love about this young generation, because they just don't give a fuck. They are on their own vibrational wavelength, on a whole nother wave. And they're not trying to conform to the ideas of us, their elders. And honestly, I believe that that's what's needed to spark real change, real revolution. But you have to, you know, how do you recode your emotional architecture for fearlessness and accelerated success, right? It speaks of the notion, I want my gold right now in the here and now, not in the here and after, right? I want my wealth, if I'm going to be wealthy, if I'm going to be healthy, if I'm going to be powerful, I want it right now, today, not 10 years from now, not 20 years from now, not when I'm 100, you know, I want my shit now, right? Accelerated success. I believe it's important to embrace the messiness within change, because that's where your expansion lives. Average performers and the mediocre love to talk about others, right? We fawn over that shit. Gossiping, you know, shade, and what's the tea, and, you know, talking about others. That's a sign of mediocrity. Because the iconic producers, the real mystics, are obsessed with discussing their dreams, right? That's yoga. All the great yogis in history would spend hours and hours and hours in the depths of meditation, and they'd go to whole other dimensions. Yogananda talks about this. The Buddha talks about this. How to access Shakti and that Kundalini energy and bring that thing up, and so you can just meditate and ascend up all of the ladder rungs of your chakras, right? Right? Obsessed with talking about their future, the vision, shaping the vision into the physical, right? The words you use drive the energy you feel. And to rise to exceptional, you need to tap into your natural reservoir of massive energy. And so the iconic among us, the real rainmakers and bosses, leverage their words to raise their vibrational frequency. This is how gods create. Life and death are in the power of the tongue. That's what that means, literally. Life and death in the power of the tongue. The power of the tongue. What do they say? That's the whole metaphysics and science behind as a man thinketh, so he is. I've been hungry all my life. And so you have to be purpose driven to tap into your greatest windows of opportunity. To tap into those windows of juicy opportunity. Pay any price to stay in the presence of extraordinary people. Because access makes the world go around. I've come to a point in my life where I realize my time is so valuable that if I'm going to invest my time around people, either I need to be feeding them or they need to be feeding me. It's give and take, baby. It's give and take. You can't, you know, it's like that notion, you only want to surround yourself with, you know, the luminaries, right? People who are better than you. But the problem with that is if everybody thought that way and everybody behaved that way, those who you want to be like would never give you the time of day because they're spending their time with those they want to be like. Did you see? And so the logic doesn't really work. But, you know, theoretically, it's a beautiful concept. But the whole idea is you need to be either giving or taking. You always want to have three types of people in your life. Those who are pulling you up, who are elevating you, giving you access to exceptional ideas, shit that's revolutionary, that will revolutionize your entire legacy and lifetime, right? Those who are your equals. Because we learn from our equals better us. And those, that one friend that you can help elevate, you can help pull up. We always got to be giving back. You can't take nothing, no system, no carbon-based system can survive merely on bottom feeders that are feeding off of someone else. That's what viruses do. That's definitive viral, is to be surviving off another entity and never giving back, never that exchange, right? That yin and yang energy. But you know, you have to be purpose driven. And so today I dare you to disturb the universe. I dare you to upset the status quo of fate, you know. Just because your daddy was a certain kind of way and his daddy was a certain kind of way doesn't mean you got to be that way. Upset the status quo statistics and generational curses. Oh, because 9 out of 10 black women, blah, 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 blah. Upset that shit. purpose driven. You have to install a vision so large it frightens you to your very core. You have to find a mission so close to your heart that you take a bullet to protect it. And those who unlock your compassion are those to whom you've been assigned. You're here to serve those who help you return to your internal compass. And we all know what our internal compass is. It's that shit you're always driven back to, no matter what. It's like your zero point, right? It's not about being served, it's about serving. And we lose sight of that because we all want to get money, get paid, get better, get wealthier, get healthier, get in more enlightened, get a bigger house, a better car, a better job, right? A better chick, a better dude, a better relationship, right? But few of us are focusing and giving intention to giving back, to serving. And when I say serve, I'm not talking about, you know, like a waitress or a waiter or a servant, but more to serve at your tribe. You came here to serve your tribe. So, you know, consciously put yourself in situations designed to push you to excel. People who produce exceptional work consistently and lead their game understand that we grow by having the guts to go to the jagged edges of our highest limits on a regular basis. And by doing so, those limits expand. You know, in order to bring down the wall, you have to keep pushing against that wall. Lead from legacy versus scarcity. So many of us operate from scarcity. It's our carrot and it's our stick. Lead from legacy. Do things with generational wealth in mind. Because in this way, you'll always stand ready to exploit the most luscious and juicy opportunities. Right? To walk with the icons, you got to devote yourself to the building of a meaningful legacy. Fireproof your character. Think of your reputation as preceding you wherever you go. Because more often than not, your reputation will be what precedes you. You know, it's like people who, you know, why is it that, and maybe this is just me. Maybe I'm the only one who experiences this, but, you know, back in school, when you describe people, it wouldn't be, oh, you know, John from history class. It'd be, you know, John, the one that got caught finger banging old girl in the hall, like stuff like that. We label people with the faults. We label them with their flaws. We label them with the shit they got caught up in. And so that's your reputation, you know. A lot of times, I think, I was watching a documentary and they were talking about, what's the name of that documentary? A documentary about these singers and background singers who were just close enough to experience what it's like to be in the limelight, to have that fame, that famous life, and never quite got it. But it's like, after being, background singer for Diana Ross, that's what they carried with them forever, right? So just imagine your resume being the only thing that defines you. And so you're only being defined by the shit that you've done and experienced, not what your potential is. And that's where the windows of opportunity lie, is synonymous with our potential. So as I wrap it up, folks, do things that stimulate all five of your senses. Experience this spark, all five of your senses on all cylinders. Rich experiences are more valuable than material possessions. Because, you know, I always try to remind folks, you know, you came here alone, you will leave here alone. And you came here empty-handed, and you will leave here empty-handed. You can't take shit with you. You can't take your car with you. You can't take your house with you. You can't take your bank account with you. You can't take away. You can't take your 401k with you. You can't take people you love with you. You leave empty-handed. But one thing that will always be and resonate within your spirit, no matter what lifetime, no matter what your consciousness, no matter where you ascend to, your experiences will be indelibly etched in your essence. That's what wealth is all about. Being able to afford freedom, opportunities, experiences that no one else can experience. It's real interesting. Real wealthy people, when they get old and they've done all they're gonna do and they, you know, they retire, one thing they start doing is traveling like crazy, right? I think recently Will Smith and his family, he took it, the whole Smith clan, to Africa. And they're doing, you know, they're on Serengetis and they're hiking and they're skydiving and all kind of shit that he never had the time to really do. I'm sure he can afford it, but, you know, just never had the time to do because of acting and, you know, obligations, responsibilities and things like that. And so a lot of wealthy people, when they get old, if you're blessed enough to get old, you know, and blessed enough to have the means to actually enjoy your elder years, you know, they start traveling and just racking up experiences, going on vacations. What do elderly people like to do? Go on vacations, be on the beach, you know what I'm saying? Just free shit for freedom, peace of mind. And you can only get those experiences by being tuned into opportunities. Windows, juicy opportunity. Let that marinate and resonate and carry that with you. Cloak that into every experience and every person you meet today. Love on your loved ones. Hug them, because, you know, tomorrow is not promised to anyone. And thank you for listening. Peace and blessings. And I'll see you next week.